everybody grab song sheets and okay, good. And there's some chocolate back there and water. I wish we could have coffee. So I am so thankful for Sunday mornings. I love coming here because it reminds me of who life really is about. It's not about me. Though it feels like it is, but it's not. So it's about the Lord. And it also brings life into focus and, you know, making the main thing the main thing. And we also get to be with our favorite people ever. You guys are our favorite people outside our family. So anybody see what's on the back table? Yes, hockey. We have hockey pucks and a hockey stick. And if you're 3 feet tall, you can play with the stick and the hockey puck. So Rick's sermon title is "A Hockey Puck Just Won't Work." And he's going to be talking about God's plan to rescue us. It's a beautiful plan. So this week, I've been trying to read the Psalms that correlate with the date of the day. So I've been reading in Psalm 16, 17, 18. And I love Psalm 18 says this. "He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He rescued me because he delighted in me. My God turns my darkness into light." All right, so let's sing. If you stand up if you can, let's worship our King. One, two, three, four. our hearts truly do hunger for only what you can give. Forgiveness, peace in the midst of these crazy circumstances in our lives. You give us hope that there's a future, and you give us security too, that each day you give us has been decreed by you. And you also give us a joyful life and lots of love that we can be grateful for. I love, Lord, what the psalmist writes, that he asks to help us to see and understand the wonders of your great love and to be satisfied with seeing your likeness. Thank you for coming to give us a home. Thank you for calling us your own. Thank you for freeing us from ourselves and rescuing us from our chains of doubt, of sin, of darkness. You are a wonderful, merciful Savior, our precious Redeemer and friend. And we thank you for loving us. Amen. Well, why don't you say good morning to your neighbor while I show people the view.
Okay, yeah, I'm all right. All right. Well, you guys are having a great time. I hate to break it up. Yeah, I know. Be quiet, Rick. Let them talk, right? I encourage you to grab a seat. We'll keep rolling here. If I can get Lori to sit down. Okay, let me just lead us in a moment of prayer here. Father, we thank you for another beautiful day that we can gather. And again, thank you just that we have the freedom to openly come and worship you. And there are brothers and sisters all over the world who would love to have that freedom that we enjoy and just take for granted. So we thank you for it. Lord, we know that there are a number of our members of our church that can't be with us today because they're dealing with physical illnesses, and Lord, we want to pray for them in particular. We know that several are dealing with some pretty serious issues, and Lord, we just pray that they'll know that we're thinking about them and that we love them, and most of all, they know that you love them and that their lives are in your hand. We pray for healing and for strength and for comfort for them. And Lord, just that reality reminds us that ultimately life very uncertain, and certainly the most obvious lesson in the last 2 years is you have no idea what's going to happen next, and we don't. But we do have an idea, a very solid idea of what's going to happen to us ultimately, because we know our lives are in your hand and you love us. And so, Father, we praise you because you're a God who loves us, cares for us, is interested in us, and is involved in all the events of our lives. And we trust you with all of it, Father. And Lord, we confess that all too often we kind of take you for granted, take for granted what we have been given. And we pray that you'll use this morning to remind us of the great gift that we have through faith, through your grace. And we pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. So Sergeant Lester Tanner was a Jewish American who fought in the U.S. Army and Europe in World War II, saw frontline combat duty. He was involved in the Battle of the Bulge in late 1944. And as a result of that, he, along with his unit, actually ended up being almost 1,300 soldiers, were captured by the Germans at one point when they were surrounded, cut off. And they were taken by the Germans to a prisoner of war camp that they called Stalag 9A. And Tanner said that prior to that, they had already been hearing the stories about what the Nazis were doing to the Jewish people. And so some of the officers in his company had said, you know, if you're Jewish, you might want to ditch your ID tags, because on the ID tags, it identifies your religion. So if you're Jewish, you might want to just lose that so that you're not, you know, if you ever get captured, there won't be a problem. Well, he did get captured, like I said, almost 1,300 of them. And at one point in this POW camp, the Nazi commander announced that the next morning they were going to require all of the Jewish soldiers from this unit to line up in front of the barracks. And they would, if they found any who were Jewish and didn't line up, they were going to shoot them immediately. Well, the American that was leading, he was the senior guy over the American POWs, was a man named Roddy Edmonds. He's a Protestant from Tennessee. He informed the Germans that all of the Americans would line up. They're not going to put up with this stuff of singling out Jewish people. He said, if you want people to line up, we'll all line up tomorrow morning. Well, the Nazis didn't like that. But sure enough, the next morning, all of the 1,300 American POWs lined up in front of the barracks. And Major Sigmund, who was the German commander, was very angry. And Roddy said to him, we're all Jews here. Well, Sigmund said, you can't all be Jews. And so Sergeant Edmund stood firm, and now furious, the Nazi major took out his pistol, a Luger, and pointed it right at Edmund's head. And he said, you order the Jewish soldiers to step forward, or I will shoot you right here, right now. And Edmund said to him, Major, you can shoot me, but if you do, you'd better shoot all of us, because we know who you are. And this war is getting near an end. And if you shoot anybody here, you are going to be a major war criminal and you're going to be found out and punished. And with that, the major just was apoplectic, but what he had heard was true. And so he turned on his heel and stomped off in anger. Lester Tanner said that and doing that, Edmonds, putting his own life at risk, he saved the nearly 200 men in that unit who were Jewish. And he said, none of us have ever forgotten what he did for us that day. You know, that's an amazing story, that one of the heroic moments of World War II that can easily slip by. And it's a stirring story. But you know, there's another story that is more stirring and of much more significance, a story of astounding courage and sacrifice and rescue. And of course, it's the story of how we have been rescued by God. How do you think you would feel if you were in a perilous situation and some person put himself in danger to rescue you, and especially if by doing so, he suffered terribly, maybe even died, to save your life? How would you feel about that person? Well, that's kind of a question that you might want to think about as we look about how we've been rescued. And we're continuing to study the book of Romans. We're in chapter 3, going to pick up at verse 21 that talks about our dramatic rescue. Here's what Paul says. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There's no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all sinned, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? Well, it's excluded because of what law? Well, the law that requires works? No, because of the law that requires faith. For we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles too? Yes, Gentiles too. Since there is only one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through that same faith. Do we then nullify the law by this faith? Not at all. Rather, we uphold the law. So this passage has a powerful theology packed into a very few verses, and it can almost be a little bit overwhelming. So what I want to do this morning is focus on three ideas that you see show up in this passage that kind of give us the idea that of the critical message that comes through here. The first idea is that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Very familiar verse 23. And that verse is really kind of summing up what Paul has been saying up until this point. You know, if you've been with us, you know that there's been this constant drumbeat of everybody's sinful, everybody's sinful, everybody's sinful. Religious, non-religious, doesn't matter, Jewish, Gentile, everybody's sinful. And now he sums it up and says, well, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The falling short of the glory of God really means the ancient Jews believed that, and correctly, that human beings were created in God's image to share in his glory because we were to bear his image. And now that image has been marred because we have all become sinful and we don't have that glory that we were created to have, that God designed for us. And this, accepting this, all of sin and fall short of the glory of God, is a crucial point we must accept. We saw this last week. If anybody's ever going to solve the problem of the human condition, this is a first step, saying there is a problem, and this is the problem. I know, all of us sinned. Every single person, yeah, you religious people, you're obsessed with the idea of sin. You know, but that's an archaic thinking. We live in a more enlightened age, and sin is just irrelevant to us. Well, you know, back that truck up, Chester. You may want to think about, we don't want to talk about sin and all that kind of stuff, but here's the problem. You know, plugging your ears and singing, la, 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 I can't hear you, doesn't make a problem go away. You know, if somebody comes along and tells us something we don't like and we don't want to hear it, and we, no, I'm not listening, it doesn't make it not true. And that's the problem here is, look at the human condition. Everyone knows when you look at people throughout history, continuing to this day, there's a problem. People aren't what they ought to be, and they don't get along very well, and we have all kinds of problems. And we ignore at our peril the problem that he is pointing out here. Sin, well, what is sin? You know, we don't talk a lot about sin anymore. Sin is just a departure from the good. You're doing something that's not perfectly good, or you are something that's not perfectly good. That's sin. So the question is, has there ever been a moment when you thought something or said something or did something that wasn't perfectly 100% pure good? No, I've always been perfectly pure all my life. Yeah, no, that's not true. We all go, yeah, no, that's not me. Well, then you've fallen short of the glory of God, because that's what the glory of God is, perfectly pure good, which means there's sin. And the problem is, sin is a departure from good if you depart from good, where do you go? Good and evil. Oh, we got a problem. Okay, so the problem is that we need to understand that this affects us. When we have evil in us, which we all do, it affects us. You know, closing your eyes to it, saying, nah, no, we're not going to believe in that stuff, it doesn't stop it from having the effects. Well, what kind of effects does it have when we have sin in our lives? Well, I'll share with you a few just this morning real quickly. First, it separates us from God. New Living Translation of Isaiah 59, verse 2 says, it's your sins that have cut you off from God. You got sin in your life? Well, yeah, I guess I do depart from good every now and then. Well, that's cut you off from God. And here's the problem. Romans 11:36, Paul wrote of God, for from him and through him and for him are all things. People are created by God for him. We are created to be in relationship with God. We have, though we don't often recognize it, we have a built-in need to be connected to God and to have a relationship with him. We are created to live in relationship with him. And so if we have sin in our life, that connection is severed, and now we don't have that connection with God, and we're going to sense that. There's going to be effects of that. And the problem for us is, we could say, well, I don't think we all need to be connected to God, but the truth is we are, and we can't help it. We need that. It's there whether we want it or not, whether we acknowledge it or not. And when we don't have that relationship with God, it's like any other human need. If we have a need in life and that need isn't fulfilled and it's a very real need, we sense the lack of whatever it is we don't have. And so if you sense something missing in life, something isn't quite right, which is true of pretty much every human being, it goes back to you need to be connected to God. That's what sin has done to us. It's cut us off. So that's the first thing. Second thing is it produces disastrous effects in our lives and in our interactions and relationships with other people. When there's sin in our lives, ultimately what that sin is going to boil down to is we're going to make everything about ourselves. We're going to be obsessed with ourselves. And when you're obsessed with yourself, then there's going to be impacts of that. And all of you have experienced this. If you've been around someone who's really selfish, self-focused, narcissistic, what happens? They damage relationships. It absolutely happens. Well, we all have a little bit of that in us, and it affects our relationships. There was a time Lori and I were on vacation with our kids, and we were on a beach, and it was a beautiful day, and Lori at one point had an air mattress. Lori loves air mattresses when you're at the beach. She loves to go float in the waves, on an air mattress. So she had this air mattress, a flotation device, next to her on the sand, and all of a sudden this really a sudden breeze just whipped up kind of out of nowhere, and it picked up that air mattress and flipped it over and blew it a little ways down the beach where it there was this teenage gal that was there on the beach not too far away, and it kind of ran into her. And Lori, in her gracious way, she got up, she's laughing, she said, oh, I'm so sorry, but thank you so much for stopping my air mattress. It was getting away, she's laughing. And the young girl was fine. The young girl's mother was not. The mother was grumpy, cranky, humorless. She said, you should keep better control of your things, and you don't know what kind of damage that could do. You're just lucky it wasn't a surfboard. What an idiotic thing to say. Excuse me, ma'am, but if it had been a surfboard, do you really think a breeze is going to pick it up and blow it down the beach? What a dumb thing to say. But the bigger issue is, what's wrong with you? You're on a beach in a beautiful day, and a simple little thing has happened that doesn't hurt anybody, and you're just being a grumpy and crabby. Why are people like that? It's because we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's the problem. And on the right day, all of us can be that lady You know, catch us in the wrong moment when we're just having a bad time. You can get that. What is that? We're sinful. And it affects how we relate to other people in lots more important ways than that. So those two things. Third, as we saw last week, I want to remind you this because it's so important. When we're sinful, it means we will never find what we are all desperate to obtain, and that is to be declared righteous. Everybody thinks that's not something we really want, and yes, it is, because we realize it's tied to our sense of worth, which the psychologists tell us is our most basic need. So in other words, not being able to be declared righteous, because we aren't righteous, deprives us of our greatest psychological need to be declared righteous and to have worth. One more effect of sin. We end up not just separated from God for a little while, but forever. We end up condemned, separated from God for eternity. The ultimate reality for all of us human beings is death, because that one is one that is going to affect every single human being permanently. And it is ominous. It is an implacable enemy that haunts us and makes a mockery of everything we do, because in the end, it's all going to go away. We need hope beyond the grave. But when we're separated from God, there is no such hope. Physicist, author, and professor at MIT, Alan Lightman, interesting, found himself considering some ultimate realities on the day his daughter got married. And, you know, those kind of events can have that kind of effect on you. And he, you know, here's his daughter. She's 30 years old. She's getting married. And he remembers her as that little girl, you know, missing a tooth, you know, cute. Now she's an adult. She's getting married. And he was escorting her down the aisle for her wedding. And he wrote these words: "Despite all the richness of the physical world, the majestic architecture of atoms, the rhythm of the tides, the luminescence of the galaxies, nature is missing something even more exquisite and grand, some immortal substance which lies hidden from view. Perhaps this immortal thing that we wish for exists beyond time and space. Perhaps it is God. I cannot believe that nature could be so amiss. I'm being sentimental. Perhaps I could accept the fact that in a few short years, my atoms will be scattered in wind and soil, my mind and thoughts gone, my I-ness dissolved in an infinite cavern of nothingness. But I cannot accept that fate, even though I believe it to be true. I cannot force my mind to go to that dark place." You hear that? Here is a man who says, "I only believe in science. I only believe in what I can touch and see and feel and hear. I don't believe in that God stuff, the spiritual stuff. I believe that when we all die, our atoms are scattered and that's the end of it. I believe that, but my mind tells me it's not true. I can't help it." Yeah, he's being honest, because that's true of all of us. Kind of wish you could say to the guy, "You know what, listen to your mind. It knows something, and you should pay attention to that. It's telling you, you need hope, that you need to go on, that your life is going to not end right at the grave. That's not the end." Sin puts us in a situation where what comes after is worse, not better. And we need hope that what we find is something better. This issue of sinning and falling short of the glory of God is a devastating problem to us. And it needs a solution. So here's the thing about the Bible. You know, the Bible tells a terrific story. When you think about a story, a drama, it has to have some central conflict, right? Something needs to be at tension, and the more serious the conflict, the more devastating the consequences of it, the more effective the story will be. And what we hope for in all of those stories is a happy ending. And we love the stories where there's a hero that comes in and rescues us from the grave peril that is the conflict. The Bible tells that story. It says we are in this terrible situation because we've sinned, we fall short of the glory of God, and we have all of the effects of that at work in our lives. And yet, there is a happy ending because there is a hero who comes to rescue us. The hero is God himself. That's the second thing you can see in this passage. It's an interesting thing. It says that God is just and the justifier. This gets at the heart of the problem that God faces. God's faced with a conundrum. You can see it in verse 26 where he says he wants to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. So the issue here is God is just. That's his character. You know, if he were not just, if he were not fair, if he did not deal with evil, he wouldn't be good. If he weren't good and if he weren't just, there's no way we would ever love him. If he were powerful but not just and not good, we might cower before him. We might, you know, have to try to do what he says because we're afraid of him. We're never going to love him. We're never going to worship him. Because he's just scary. God has to be just, has to be good. Here's the thing. By definition, evil is destructive. Wherever it exists, it destroys. It's malevolent. It brings pain and sorrow and death and destruction. And the problem is, now we've seen that all of us, we've already said, well, we've all sinned. It means there's some evil, at least some level of evil in all of us, which means there's that something that brings destruction and pain and sorrow into this world. Well, God wouldn't be good if he didn't deal with that. He has to deal with that. You know, evil is kind of like cancer. You know, if there's just one little cell of cancer floating around in your body, that holds a threat. Because what cancer does is it multiplies, it spreads, and it destroys. So, you know, if you found out you're diagnosed with cancer, and you go to a doctor, and this doctor has a cure for the cancer, you have 100% effective cure, and that doctor then says, but you know what? I'm not going to give it to you. Would he be a good doctor? No, you need him to destroy the evil in your system, to destroy the cancer, to save your life. God, to be good, has to destroy the evil. So here we are, destructive cancer cells, loose in God's universe, wreaking havoc everywhere we go, destroying his beautiful creation and on other people around us. To be good, God must deal with our evil. So God's got a conundrum because he loves us, and he wants to give us what we need, which is justification, being declared righteous, hope for eternity, all of those things we mentioned, the relationship with him. He wants to fix that problem, all those problems. But we're not just. We're not good. We're evil, and he needs to deal with that. So God has this problem. How can I be both just and yet justify these people who, in fact, are not righteous? Now, typically, human beings will come up with answers to that question that run in two directions. One direction is very typical for us human beings, and that is that, well, what God should do is incentivize human beings to do better. You know, I will give you the carrot and the stick. If you will do good, I will reward you, and if you don't do good, then I'm going to nail you, and you're going to get ruined. I'm going to smack you down because that's what I have to do to evil. Oh, okay. And he better lay out the rules for us. Well, you know, the interesting thing is that God knows that that's typically how human beings think, because that's how we think. Okay, I just need to do better. I need to know the rules, and I need to be better. And if I'm better, then everything will be fine. And so God said, well, okay, I know that's how you think. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how well that system works. And he gave us the rules. And he told us, here's what can happen if you don't obey the rules. Here's what happens if you do. Carrot and the stick. Here are the rules. Carrot, stick, have at it. How to work out. Not good. Centuries of failure because none of us can be perfectly good. Now, the other direction people might go, you'll hear this actually fairly often in our culture. Well, okay, but your Bible says that God is love. So if he loves us, why doesn't he just forgive us and accept us? You know? So Lori, last week, one day helped take care of our grandson, Wesley, little two-year-old Wesley. I got to tell you, Wesley is a delight. This kid is so cute. It's just almost should be illegal to be as cute as Wesley is. He's so much fun. We love to see him he tears around the house and just laughs, and it's just fun to be. And, you know, recently, Lori, we put up some shades in our new shades we have in our bedroom. We were fairly proud of ourselves. We were actually able to mount these things. And Michael, our son-in-law Michael, had kind of advised us a little bit on this. So when we finally got him up, Lori took a video because one of the shades is motorized. So she took a video of me lowering and raising the shade. You just push this button and up it goes, down it goes. And she sent the video to Michael. So Michael, you know, it's a 45-second video. It wasn't very exciting. Michael watched the video. He thought it was really fun. But Wesley was watching the video with him on his phone. And then when it ended, Wesley goes, "More Bapa! More Bapa!" I'm Bapa. He wants to see more video of Bapa. How could you not love that kid, right? He wants more Bapa. That's a great thing. So anyway, there's this cute kid. Lori goes over and takes care of Wesley one day, and unfortunately, Wesley was having a bad day. He had missed his nap for the previous 2 days. He hasn't slept enough, and he's having a cranky day. And his common response to everything, "Wesley, why don't we do this?" "No, no, no." No matter what she said, "No, no, no." Doesn't want to do that. "Wesley, it's almost lunchtime. Could we take your jammies off and put some clothes on?" "No, no, no. Don't want to put clothes on, you know." And Lori trotted out the old parental trick of, okay, if you ask him, "Why don't we do this?" you're not going to get the right thing. So what you do is you give him a choice. So she said, "Okay, Wesley, would you like to wear your airplane shirt or would you like to wear your truck shirt?" "No, no, no. Nothing. And so Lori ended up just going, "Okay, I'm just going to have to bite the bullet and put the clothes on him." And, you know, major meltdown, crocodile tears because he couldn't wear his jammies all day, you know. And it just was not very attractive behavior, right? So here's the question. How do you think that affected Lori's view of our grandson, Wesley? Didn't affect it at all. She loves him. And even when he's having a bad day, even when he's misbehaving, she still loves him as much as she can possibly love him. And so here's the question then, if we can do that, can't God? Can't God just love us even with all of our tantrums and our bad days and, you know, misbehavior? Well, yes and no. He can love us, but to be good, he still has to deal with the evil in us. That's the problem. That doesn't go away. To be just, to be good, to be loving, God must deal with evil and seek to eradicate it. So, God has a plan. He has this amazing plan, a plan that no human being would ever come up with. And you can see the plan in verses 24 and 25. "All are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith." You know, ancient Jews understood the sacrifice of atonement. The Greek term that Paul uses translated atonement is the word that actually meant mercy seat. And you remember Raiders of the Lost Ark? Remember that you saw the movie and they had the Lost Ark there, and it actually was a pretty good representation of what the Ark probably looked like. And on the top, there's this flat area. That was the mercy seat where the blood of sacrifices would be sprinkled to indicate that somehow God is going to make provision for punishing our sin that's going to involve not our death, but the death of someone else. Now, in that case, it was the death of animals. And of course, you think, well, how could the death of an animal cover my wrong and my evil? Well, that's a good question. But God, the point of this, what he's saying here, is that God has dealt with our evil in Jesus Christ. You know, you remember in Raiders of the Lost Ark, right there in the last, near the end of the movie, when they opened the ark and all of a sudden these lightning bolts came flashing out of the ark and zapped all of the Nazis. And you go, yeah, that's what they deserve because they were evil. God got them. He got the evil one. You go, yes, that's what it should be. And the problem is, that's us. And yet what he says, here's how God dealt with it. Jesus Christ stood in front of us and took the zap that was intended for us, for all of us. Yeah, but how can one person dying be enough for everybody? Because, you know, the reality is, the scripture we saw last week says that every moment of our lives is actually touched in some way by sin in us. Every single moment. Even our good things we do are, in fact, tainted by sin. And when you think about that, you think, okay, over a lifetime, how many sins does that add up to? It's a bunch. A big bunch. Okay, now let's multiply that huge big bunch by the billions of people who have lived throughout history. How big is that number? It's approaching infinity. How do you deal with that? You have an infinite person die for the infinity of sin that is the human race. Can God really do that and be just? What about the real evil that even if he has done that actually still exists in us? Well, here's the good news. The evil has been punished. You know, the zap has happened. The sacrifice has died. So the punishment has occurred. And what God says is now we are forgiven and accepted, declared righteous by him, by his grace, because of what Jesus has done for us. And now God is actually going to go to work on the evil that exists in us and begin removing it. And someday, that process isn't going to be complete when we're in this life, but someday, Scripture says, when we see Jesus face to face, we're going to be just like him. All the evil is going to be gone, and we will be restored to the glory of God, what God originally designed us for. That sounds good. How do we make that happen? Well, that's a very good question. We can only be declared righteous by God by faith. This is what we do about the problem. Verse 22 says, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Verse 28, we maintain a person is justified, which means declared righteous, by faith, apart from works of the law. Well, actually, once again, it literally says apart from works of law. It doesn't matter what your law is. You're not going to get declared righteous by trying to do it. Excuse me. We're not going to solve the problem that way. But we can be declared righteous, have all these things that are the effect of sin begin to be resolved by faith, by believing what God promises us. We actually now have two options. Because of our sin, there's a debt to be paid, a penalty that must be levied, and we have a choice. We can accept the penalty ourselves, deal with it, you know, have all the consequences on ourselves, or by faith we can let Jesus take care of it for us. That seems like a better plan, don't you think? It does to me. But that raises the question. It seems like a no-brainer, but it seems too easy, doesn't it? By faith, you just believe who Jesus was and what he did for us. That's it? Yeah, that's it. is this one of those deals where there's a catch? You know, here's this offer. We have an offer. It's too good to refuse. And what you don't realize is, yeah, but you know what? There's all this fine print down there that has a bunch of legalese that if you could wade through all that stuff, you're going to go, well, that's a terrible deal. Is this what we got? No, there's no fine print. This is it, by faith. It's interesting that in verse 24, he says we are justified freely by his grace. Our translation says, literally it says, justified as a gift. It's a gift. How do you get a gift? What do you have to do to get a gift, a free gift? Just accept it. It's Christmas. Okay, there's all these presents to me. Now, that one that's got my name on, what do I have to do to get that? You just receive it. It's for you. You mean I just believe that this is really for me and open it and receive it as mine? Yeah, that's it. It's what God is offering us. So, you know, that's an interesting thing. It makes you wonder, why is faith the thing that God says we need to have? Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Faith is what God wants. Why faith? Well, actually, if you look at life, you can kind of see that that's how things are in this world, that faith is the key thing. And this way, you know, when you look around in life, and every Christian has had this question at some points and probably at a number of points in life. Why doesn't God make it more obvious? Why doesn't God just show up every now and then if he's really there, right? Don't you wonder about that? I do. Like, why? You know, God, he's so powerful. You know, he could just say, you know, about every 20 or 30 years, I'm just going to show up, you know, say, okay, everybody out of the pool, you know, I've got something to say here. Or why doesn't he just, you know, reveal himself in some way? Why is he not more obvious? It almost feels like he's playing hide and seek with us sometimes, doesn't it? Why is that? It is because he wants us to live by faith. We are convinced that if we just had some proof that we could see and touch, well then, wow, then look out, we'd really believe. Yeah, well, go back and look in history at what happened when God did miracles that blew people's minds. How'd that go? They went, ooh, cool, I really believe God now. And 2 weeks later, they don't believe him anymore. Right? Look at the people of Israel. God parts the sea. Wow, we walk through an ocean. That was unbelievable. And weeks later, they're going, eh, we're out here to die in the wilderness. God's not going to take care of us. Who is this God guy? What is that? That's human nature. Jesus Christ comes into the world and he walks around healing people right and left, walking on water and doing unbelievable things, and most of them don't believe him. What? Did you see what he just did? It's not sight. It's faith. It's always faith. I'm going to talk some more next week about why faith is so critical, but I'm going to give you just one reason why I believe God has chosen faith today as the critical point, and it is this. Faith is something any human being can do. You know what? We exercise faith all the time. You cannot live in this world without exercising faith. We can't make ourselves good enough to be declared righteous by God. We've tried it, and it didn't work, and we know that, and people have tried it for thousands of years, and it's never worked. It won't work. But we can have faith. You know what? I exercise faith every single night, and so do you, when I go to bed. You know, I've always thought that that prayer that they teach kids, you know, is a little scary. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep, and if I should die before I wake. Wait, what? What are we talking about here? You know, that's going to help the kids sleep really well. If I should die before I wake? Imagine if it's time for bed and you're about to go to bed, and you're not sure you're going to wake up once you go to sleep. You're going to want to go to sleep? You know, I'm a little afraid, you know, this whole sleep thing. I mean, where do I go? Suddenly I'm unconscious, and maybe I'll never wake up. You going to want to go to sleep? I don't think so. Every single night I go to bed, and I have no fear whatsoever of going to sleep, because throughout my entire life, every time I've gone to sleep, I've awakened the next day. I have a long history, and I believe that's what's going to happen, and I exercise faith that that will happen. The truth is, it doesn't always happen. I have an uncle that one day, wasn't feeling particularly good. He was 89 years old, and he laid down to rest, and he went to sleep, and he was gone. Never woke up. Actually, sounds like a pretty good way to go, don't you think? But the truth is, it doesn't always work out the way we want, and yet we live by faith. Every single night, we don't even think about it. Oh, I'm going to sleep. Be great. I'll wake up in the morning. See you in the morning. How do you know that? By faith. Come on, Rick. You know, here, there's faith everywhere. I get a bank statement from my bank, and they say, here's how much money you have in your bank account. How do I know that's true? I don't have any evidence that's true, that number is correct. I mean, what's actually there? Well, there's some ones and zeros in a computer someplace. That's it. You know, there's no tangible thing I can put my hands on and say, yeah, there's actually a thing there. And yet, I believe it. I just exercise faith. Every day you go out, and when we're done here, you're going to go out and you're going to get into your car and you're going to drive home. And you are exercising tremendous faith that the people driving around you aren't going to do something crazy and slam into you. We exercise faith. We can't live without it. So God says, I'm going to give you something that is going to be the critical element, because every human being does it, and that proves that we can do it. What do I have to do? You believe. Jesus said, when people came to him and they said, what are the works of God that we must do? And he says, believe in the one he has sent. That's the work. You know, it's really important that we understand that it's not actually the act of having faith that is itself valuable. Faith only has value in relation to its object. For instance, if a person says, okay, you know, that's kind of our culture wants to say, well, you just have to have faith. It doesn't really matter what the content of your faith, just believing. That's what, having faith is what matters. Great. I believe that hockey puck back there on the table is in control of the universe and can save me. How valuable is that faith? It is worthless, because its object is worthless. A hockey puck just won't do the job. It can't save you. It's a puck, for goodness sakes. That's all it is. No power. You know, one day last week, Lori went to the grocery store. She planned to make a dish for dinner that actually required having, one of the ingredients was Fritos. So she goes to the store. She had a list of things she was going to buy. She goes to the chip aisle, and you know what? COVID struck. There's no Fritos. I got to ask you, when was the last time you went to a grocery store and they didn't have Fritos? There's Fritos coming out their ears in the grocery store every time. You know, they always go, oh, let's put the Fritos out there on an end cap thing, you know, so because we got a bunch of Fritos we got to sell. No Fritos. Lori went to the store in faith that they would have Fritos. Found out that faith was of no use because the grocery store didn't come through. Well, it's a supply chain issue. I don't care. I just want my Fritos. Too bad. It's not just having faith. It's what the object of your faith is that matters. Having faith that God has in fact solved our problem, made it possible for us to be declared righteous, to be accepted by Him, to be in a relationship with Him where He loves us no matter what goes on in our lives, and to have eternal life because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, and He's given this to us as a gift. And all we have to do is believe it and accept it. That's the message here. In all the world, there really is no other effective alternative for dealing with the human problem. Every other proposed solution will either not deal with the problem, will be impossible, or will require that God not be good and just. It will fail in one of those areas. There is no other sacrifice. We are left with a choice to either accept our just punishment ourselves or by faith to accept what Jesus has done for us. So the obvious thing to do is to put our trust in Jesus, right? And accept what he offered, to believe. But and Paul is going to discuss at some length as we go on in the book of Romans how that should affect us. But I want to just point out today, what should that do for us when we put our trust in Jesus? When we know that we are have been declared righteous by God and have a relationship with him. Well, I think the first thing it should do is it should produce great relief and joy. You know, a few years ago, I had been dealing with some physical issues and finally led to a doctor telling me something I absolutely didn't want to hear. He said, you know, we're going to need to do a biopsy. You know, when doctors do biopsies, they're not looking for evidence that you're exceptionally healthy. You know, we're going to do a biopsy to find out how come you are so healthy. What is it with your tissue? That's not what they're looking for. We all know what they're looking for. They're looking for cancer. And it's like, oh, great, biopsy. You're looking to find out how come I'm so studly, right? No, that's not it. So our reaction to that is, uh-oh. So I have this thing, you know, scheduled the test. You got it hanging over you, you know. And, of course, I made a huge mistake. You know, the Internet, what a curse the Internet is. It's like you've got symptoms, they're going to do a biopsy. I think I better go look this up on the Internet. Oh, boy, you know where that goes. Oh, no, I've got it, I'm going to die. You know, this is all bad. Oh, no, that's how that goes. So then finally they come in to do the biopsy, and that was as much fun as having someone pull your fingernails out with pliers. It was just painful. Got through it, and now you have to wait a couple of days before for the results to come back. So you wait. A couple of days later, I get a phone call from the doctor's office, and I thought, well, you know, I've been expecting a nurse to call and say, well, your results were blah, blah, blah. It wasn't the nurse. It was the doctor. And I thought, oh, no, this is not going to be good. And the doctor says, oh, well, Mr. Myatt, happy to tell you that the results were negative. You have no problems. You know what happened there? I felt really good. Oh, really? Yeah, you're good. No problems there. I almost felt giddy. You know how that feels? It's just like, what a weight lifted off. And the rest of that day, you know, even if something bad happened, I go, well, that's bad, but you know what? The test was negative. I just am happy about that. I felt really good about it. Well, we have gotten some news that's way better than a negative test result. It is God has solved our biggest problem in a way that we would never have thought of. We've been given an unbelievable gift, which means, yeah, you know what? I'm going to go through life and hard things are going to happen and they'll be hard and I'll feel all that goes with that. But underlying all of that, there is this joy, this relief. My biggest problem has been solved and I have hope. That's what that should produce for us. A second thing it should do for us is it should humble us. You know, you're saying that, okay, you've got the problem solved that everybody else has still, and you know, God has given you this gift, and a lot of other people don't have it. Isn't that going to make you kind of smug, sort of superior? Absolutely not, because how did I get it? I got it by admitting that I can't help myself and I need help. And God, in His grace and His goodness and His kindness and His mercy, has done an unbelievable thing, paid a huge price to rescue me. That's humbling. I don't deserve this, and I'm no better than anybody else because whatever they've got going, I got my own stuff. I got no reason to look down on them. I just have been given a great gift, and I'm very thankful for that. It's going to create great humility. And then one last thing. It should fill our hearts with gratitude and love for God every single day. Underlying everything else, we should be so thankful to God and love Him because He has loved us in a way that no one else ever will. or ever could. You know, the amazing thing about this gift is it's not a gift where God has said, okay, you know what, I'm going to give you this gift, but here's the deal. I'm going to be looking over your shoulder, and you know what, if you don't treat that gift right, and if you don't take care of that gift, you don't fly right, I'm yanking that gift back. Not that kind of deal. God has said, unconditional, there it is. It's yours. Well, what do I have to do? Just believe. Just accept. Wow. This is amazing. That means God just, he loves me and that's it. And he's done all this. And now I have a relationship with him and he wants me to actually come and talk to him. Yeah, even when you're having a bad day and you're, you know, upset because you can't wear your jammies today, you know, God still loves you. He's still there. Well, you know what? That means we should love him back and be grateful to him every day of our lives, shouldn't we? That's what this should do for us. There's an interesting question at the end of this chapter that I want to just point out. Verse 31, after all of this, Paul says, do we then nullify the law by this faith? You know what? It kind of seems like it, doesn't it? I mean, isn't Paul saying all of this that now God has done for you is, it means you don't have to worry about the law. You don't have to try to live up to the law because you can't. You can't get it that way. And so don't worry about that anymore. It seems like Paul has said, yep, we've nullified the whole thing. All of that thousands of years of history and all of that great theology and all that stuff in the Old Testament, never mind. And Paul says, no, the truth is we don't nullify it. We actually uphold that law. Well, how do you see that happening, Paul? You know what? Come back next week, and he's going to tell you in chapter 4, and you'll see it, and you'll go, that is amazing that Paul, in fact, is establishing the law of God while seeming to set it aside. So come back next week, you know. We'll start with a previously in Romans and next week to catch you up, but just kidding. Okay, let's pray. Father, we are humbled this morning as we see your unbelievable plan to rescue us. We are amazed that this is a plan we would never have thought of, that's for sure. But we're so glad that you thought of it, and not only thought of it, but have carried it out. And in so doing, have rescued us. Have given us hope for eternity, have reconnected us to you, have given us the possibility of starting to see sin's effects in us and on our relationships being cured, and to have the incredible privilege of being declared righteous by you when in fact we know on our own we are not. Father, we thank you for this. We love you for this. Lord, we're caused to rejoice because we have been given an unbelievably great gift. Thank you for it. Thank you for loving us so, Father. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son. And we're going to sing that as we end this morning. One, two. Thank you. grateful that our hero saved us and we can walk with him in great joy. So glad you're here, and we'll see you next week. 1, 2, ready, go.